الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا صدق الله العظيم. عن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا خرج من الخلاء قال الحمد لله الذي أذهب عني الأذى وعافاني. رواه ابن ماجه. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين. درش فله Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home. In the last session of Darse Hadith, I did explain to you how the shaitan operates in his mission to deceive the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ummah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And alhamdulillah, through the barakah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we find in the ahadith clear explanations how the shaitan implements his strategy, how he works. This is the barakah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just to refresh the memories, if you remember last week, I did say to you that each group of the non-Muslim shayateen are divided into different divisions, different groups, they have different titles. Believe me you, and the government of the non-Muslim shayateen is a powerful government. It can overpower and topple any form of power, any type of regime. It's a powerful system, efficient system. And if you remember the Walhan non-Muslim jinns, titled as the Walhan, they operate the minute one starts to make wuzu, straight away. And their aim is to create dissatisfaction in wuzu, to make an individual dissatisfied, uncertain when he has completed his ghusl, to make life miserable for him. Even if he has done wuzu, even if he has made ghusl, he still is not content. The confidence is not there. He feels unsatisfied in his wuzu. And the minute wuzu is completed, the second division shayateen come in straight away. Not as in second division football-wise. At least we are fortunate that Leicester are in the Premier Division, in the first division. But this is not, this division is totally different. Totally different. It's set, the system is set. The first group goes in, that is the Walhan Shayateen. The minute wuzu is completed and they wait, the second group are ready, all geared up to go in. And the minute he says Allahu Akbar Takbir Tahreema starts, the Hans of Shayateen come in. And they try to create discrepancy in the Salah, to disturb him in his Qiraat, to disturb him in his Surat, to disturb him in his Ruku, in his Sujood. He forgets to make Dua after the Namaz has been completed. He forgets everything. He forgets which Rakat he is reading. He makes mistakes in his Salah. And this is all the power, the plot, the ploy of the Hans of Shaitan. And it continues. The list continues. We have another group of shayateen who are known as the Zalambur shayateen. Who are they? Zalambur shayateen. Powerful shaitan. And they operate in areas where transaction is made. Businesses. They are in shops, retail outlets, wholesale stores, business stores, factories, and shopping malls. That's where they operate, the Zalambu Shayateen. They force the proprietors of businesses to lie. And what they do is they praise falsely the goods, the commodities that they have, just to get rid of it. And unfortunately, even some Muslims would go as far as saying, Allah ni qasam, don't worry, you know, subhanallah, you can't go wrong, buy this from me. I'm telling you, it's the best bargain you can get. Allah ni qasam. These are professional business people. Some of the people are immaculate. I mean, they have beards, they are there in the front stuff. But you sometimes wonder how genuine they are in their qasams. This is Zalambur Shaitan taking effects in that individual. Zalambur Shaitan forcing him that you want to get rid. You want to get rid of item, hook or by crook. Get rid of it. Like, Qasam is nothing. Allahu Akbar. Qasam is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's Allah. Qasam. Allah is Qasam. Buy this car, you can't go wrong. Qasam, buy this. And subhanallah. And in reality, that commodity, that item is not to that value. But he just wants to get rid of it. And he will put Allah's name in the middle. It's really sad, my respected brothers, especially in businesses. We have to be clean. We shouldn't dodge the inland revenue people. We should be clean. We should only claim if we have to. We should give the right figures to this country. Alhamdulillah, we are living in a good country, a civilized country. Why should we take advantage? This is not Darul Harb. I've said it to you so many times. We can practice Islam in this country freely, which one couldn't even in some Muslim country. You couldn't do that in Muslim country. Sitting on this minbar, man of the pulpit. You think it's easy here, sitting here to speak out. Everything is recorded. Recorded by the A team and recorded by the B team, people that are here, the Muslims. Everything. And in some Muslim countries you are restricted. In some Arab countries the ulama are given letterheads that no, this is your topic. He won't even know what he has to speak out on a Friday. Just before the khutbah, the entire bayan is given to him in Arabic. This is what the king says, this is what you have to say now. You can't say anything else. Subhanallah. I won't say long live the queen, but I will say may Allah give them all the hidayat. Say Ameen. May we see the flag of Islam in our life. In Iran, in America, in modern Europe, and in India. Say inshallah. In our life, see Muslims everywhere. In everywhere. Subhanallah. This is how the shaitan works. The Zalambur Shaitan. And another type of shaitan which is mentioned in the Kutubs, he's a powerful shaitan. And I believe he's the one who's really busy in Europe. Very, very busy. Very busy. He is known as the A'war Shayateen. Who is he known as? A'war, Alif and Han. A'war. What is it? A'war Shayateen. He is powerful. And he dwells in areas like casinos, nightclubs, discotheques, universities, shows, theaters, and any unrestricting mixed gathering, the A'war Shaitan will be there. Anyway, university hostels, the amount of zina that takes place in universities, Allahu Akbar Kabira. You learn everything there in the university. Everything is there. It's a big gamble. And this A'war Shaitan, his mission is only one. What he does is he creates the lust of zina in the heart. He gives you that picture of a woman that you see. And that is what he does. So you want to fornicate, you want to do zina all the time. Zina is in your mind all the time. And he works on you. He creates the introduction for zina for you, paving the path for you to take you to that zina. This is the hour shayateen. That's why you see those people, for my young friends that are here, alhamdulillah, we are Muslims. We should save ourselves from zina. So important. Our youth especially, and everybody in general, everyone. And you want to see the people who take drugs. You should see their faces. You see that person who is an alcoholic, and you see that person who takes drugs. There is no noor on his face. The noor of Iman is totally wiped out from his face. He's there. You can tell, oh, he takes drugs. Why? Because the Ahwar Shaitan is with him 24 hours. Indirectly, the Shayateen manipulate with that individual. It becomes mission impossible to dissociate from that Shaitan. You can't disconnect from him. He becomes part of you. You become part of the Ahwar Shaitan. The Ahwar Shaitan becomes part of you. And the jinns have the power. They can transform themselves. They have the power. They can go in you and go out straight away. This is what they do. They take control of youth. Our shayateen. This continues. We have to recognize our enemies. This is what the Quran says to us. Ya ayyuha an-nas, O mankind, inna wa'da Allahi haqqun. The promise that Allah gives you is a true promise. The promise that Allah gives to you is a true promise. Subhanallah, Allah will not break his promise. He has promised you Jannat. And if your life is in conformity with the Sharia, with the teachings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the style that is of being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you with Jannat, the garden of bliss. An individual, no human being has the mind to even picture Jannat. Nothing. You can't even picture Jannat, my respected brother. You can dream of anything in the world, but you can't dream of Jannat. This is what Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. That is the Jannah. He promises you that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فلا تغرنكم الحياة الدنيا. So let not the present life deceive you. Let not the present life deceive you. فلا تغرنكم الحياة الدنيا. Jannah is there. Don't be deceived. Don't let this dunya give you a dhoka. People give you a dhoka. Family members give you a dhoka. But look, don't let this dunya give you a dhoka. فَلَا تَغُرَنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. And then Allah says, وَلَا يَغُرَنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ. Subhanallah. And don't let the chief deceiver deceive you. Don't let the chief deceiver deceive you. Who is the chief deceiver that is mentioned in the Quran? Al-Gharoor. Don't let the Gharoor deceive you. Gharoor is the chief deceiver. And the chief deceiver is who? Walhan, Hanzab, A'law, Zalambur. All the non-Muslim shayateen. All the non-Muslim jinns, they are the enemies. We have to recognize our enemies. That is an art also. Inna shaytana lakum aduun. Verily, the shaitan is your enemy. Aduhun. فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. So treat him as your enemy. So anything that is affiliated to the shaitan becomes automatically haram. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. He is your enemy. Treat him like your enemy. إِنَّمَا يَدْعُوا حِزْبَهُ لِيَكُونُ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. He invites his lobby, his followers, to be part of one system, لِيَكُونُ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ, to take part in that blazing fire of hell. This is what Allah is saying. Sa'ir, blazing fire of hell. So we have to recognize the shaitans and how the shaitan works. So every time we have this problem, you must remember, all right, the Ahwa Shaitan is doing this, the Zalambu Shaitan is doing that. Every time you sell something in a deceitful way, that means more points are given to the Zalambu Shaitan. Every time the desire for fornication comes in you, that means the Ahwa Shaitan is close to you. Every time you are not satisfied with your wuzu and ghusl, that means that the Wal'an Shaitan has touched you. Incredible! They are so powerful. The enemies of human beings, that's why Allah said, Ya ayyuhal nas, He didn't say Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu. As a whole, irrespective of his religion, culture and creed, they hate human beings. They don't like human beings. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has appointed an angel every time. So when we walk, if that angel was not there, subhanallah, they would assassinate, kill every single human being one by one. That is what they did in the time of Sulaiman alayhi salam. If one was walking on the bridge, they would push him. That is why even when you are flying, they have no control of the plane. Some jinns are such that they never touch down here. They're up in the air, floating up only, they only stay up. And just one touch to that plane, everything would go down. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is protecting us. مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَانِ That aircraft that is there. When Indians travel, when we travel, we have to, how many kilos do we take? 35 kilos. How many kilos? 35 kilos. English people, when they are traveling, you know, just one handbag or something. You should see the flights when we went to see in the Manchester airport for the flight going to Islamabad. Allahu Akbar, 45 kilos in preparation, taking half of England to Pakistan. And what have we prepared for the government, my respected brothers? What have we prepared? Subhanallah al-Azim. Who is going to come with us today? Malala? Your wife? Or your wife? Or your kids? Or whom? No one, my brothers. Your aman only. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed the prophets to show us the light from darkness, to show us what is right and what is wrong. That is why Anbiya alayhi salam came. That is why we have a criterion. We are muhtaj of wahi. Otherwise we won't know from head to tail is nothing. We have another group of shaitan who is known as the wasim shaitan. What is it? The wasim shaitan. The wasim shaitan, they are also unique. The wasim shaitan are stationed at the doorstep of each individual's house. So the minute you open the door, if you are the owner of it, or someone is there and he rings the bell, you have your own alarm systems. But subhanallah, the wasim shaitan is there monitoring your house 24 hours a day. Each shaitan is assigned from row 1 to, and subhanallah, he attacks the Muslim in many folds, in many folds. Muslim is his greatest enemy. And enemies come in categories. First is a Muslim, then another, then another, and then another. Inshallah, as we progress, I will give you a clear explanation. And the minute somebody rings the bell, the wasim shaitan is there, vigilant. And what does he do? Simple job, but think of it. Maybe simple to you. His mission is only one. The wal'an shaitan can't intervene. The khalz of shaitan can't intervene. The ahwa of shaitan can't intervene. This is his area. Mind your own business. What will they say? What will they say? Mind your own business. You have your own assignment. We have our own assignment. Hame tamam kaam karo. Hame amal kaam kare. Don't say too much wasim, brother. Getting me worried here. It's waw, alif, seen and mean. And it's pronounced wasim. So, wasim, okay, we can talk, I know where the mind is going now. But this is wasim. The wasim, that is what they are known as. And what they do is they make that individual who wants to enter the home oblivious from making salah. They make him forget to make salah. So when he enters the house, he is totally oblivious from the Islamic greeting code, that is Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. They make that individual forget to make salam. So when he enters the house, he doesn't make salam. And when you make salam, salam is Allah's name, and there is great fazilat of salam. It is said when you make salam, the rahmat of Allah descends, and peace and harmony is created because of that one salam in the entire family. The family is closely bonded because of that one salam. Close ties are there because of one salam. And the minute you are restricted from that shaitan from making salam, all the doors are open for him because there is no rahmah. And what does he do? Normally what happens, the wife is arguing with the husband. The husband is arguing with the wife for petty things, small things. Brother and sisters fighting, quarreling, 20 minutes fighting, argument there, argument upstairs, argument in the kitchen, argument in the living room. Husband is fighting with wife. Wife doesn't want to listen to the husband. You go your way, I'll go my way. The children are being affected. The entire family is like a non-Muslim family. Why? Why? Because we don't have value of just one sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That one sunnah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, can save lives, can save families. If you want to create peace and love and harmony, subhanallah, that is what you do. That is what you do. I was in Portugal and a Hindu lady came to me. She says, Bapu, I said, hey. She said that, oh, my husband is going out with another woman and I am from India and here he is going out with a Portuguese woman, and you know, I know you are Muslims and you have a lot of power and you will write something for me and my husband will come back to me. And I said, yes, we normally do that. And I was wondering, I was in a dilemma. I said, what to write? Because normally if it's a Muslim, we can write ayats of the Quran and whatever ta'weez we have to do, we can do that. That is fine. But here, the subject is a non-Muslim. We have to be extra delicate. And she says, no, I have a lot of hope in you, Bapu, you know. Bapu made me feel really old, but it was alright. You know, she was saying it with great respect. She came to the masjid. And I said, okay, fine, why don't you do me one favor? Say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Why are you a Hindu? All these problems will automatically dissolve the minute you say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And she started to speak to me in Gujarati, Nay, nay, Mali Sahib, we can't do that. Badu ekkaj chene. I go, Ben, badu ekkaj nathi. Please, ekkaj nathi. You worship Shivling and all sorts. Badu ekkaj nathi. We believe in Allah as-Samad. Allah al-Nazi la ilaha illallah. We believe in the Rabb of Musa, in the Rabb of Ibrahim, in the Rabb of Subhanallah Sulaiman. All the prophets that came. What do you mean everything is one and same? No. Eventually Allah gives hidayah to who He likes. Anyway, she came to me. I won't say what I wrote. I wrote something and I said, all right. You know, blow this on the food and you put it under the pillow and gave her all the full prescription, and she did amal with it, mashallah. And after 1 month she became mu'taqida. She says, oh Mana, you have changed my life. My husband is mine and he just wants to stay with me and he's there 24 hours with me. And the entire scenario changed. Everything changed. Subhanallah. You see, who is doing it? Allah, accept Iman. She says, maybe one day. Maybe one day. Allahu Akbar. But this is the barakat of one salam. So when you say Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, peace, harmony, love is created in the family. The minute you forget to say As-Salaam, Allahu Akbar, friction comes in the family. That bonding is dismantled by the shaitan. Very, very, subhanAllah, very important you make salam. And the list continues, my respected brothers and elders. Shaitan is powerful, very, very powerful. And he is the greatest liar. What does he do? He lies a lot. Non-Muslim jinns, you can't beat them. They are kazzaboon, they lie a lot. Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu was salam, when he was on his ship that he constructed himself and the group of mu'mineen who were with him, there was one individual which Nuh alayhi salam saw. And Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam could recognize him. Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam went to him because he was one unidentified individual sitting on one side. Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam went to him and said to him that, "Who are you? Who are you? I don't recognize you." And he was very, very straightforward. He said, "I am the son of Iblis." Who am I? So don't forget, we are going as far back as Nuh alayhi salam. The first prophet, Nabuwat was given to Adam alayhi salam, then Shish alayhi salam, then Idris alayhi salam, then straight away Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam was the first Rasul. He was the first Rasul acquainted with Nabuwat and Risalat. Adam alayhi salam was a Nabi, he was a Rasul. With Sharia law, with commandments he came. So that way he was the first Rasul. So he said, I want to make tawbah on your hands. I want you to ask forgiveness on behalf of me to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah would forgive me, that Allah's mercy would come to me, and I want to become a Muslim. Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam, for promoting and propagating Islam for 950 years. How many years, my brothers? He didn't see night, he didn't see day. He didn't see night, he didn't see day. And his da'wat, Allahu Akbar, is unique, unique, totally unique. Anbiya alayhimu salam, you can't match them. And subhanallah, in the hadith, Mufassireen say only approximately 80 people have embraced Iman on the hands of Nuh alayhi salam. Imagine the sabr he had, 950 years and only approximately 80 followers. Look at their hearts, sealed totally. They perished totally, finished. They were wiped out. And Hazrat Nuh, he said that, "I want to make tawbah on your hands." Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam straight away making dua, supplicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Ya Allah, forgive him. Shower your mercy on this son of Iblis." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Nuh alayhi salam, "O Nuh, my mercy with the jinns is still conditional." Is still conditional. Tell that jinn, the son of Iblis, even now, if he was to bow down and prostrate in front of the grave of Adam alayhi salam, I will forgive him. Tell him to go now and prostrate to make sajda near the grave of Adam alayhi salam, and I will forgive him. My mercy will encompass him. Tell him to make sajda. And the minute Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam told him that, that evil nature bounced back. The evil nature bounced back, and he said that, "Oh Nuh, my father didn't make sajda in front of Adam alayhi salam when he was alive. Do you think I am going to do sajda in the condition of him being demised? Do you think I'm going to do sajda when he has passed away?" This is how cunning the shaitan is. Subhanallah al-Azim. That is why Hazrat Khaja has said, a few more very important points which I want to talk to you. Don't want you to run away and say, "I'm only something more than a KTH and we don't want to sit there." Please sit, my brothers, inshallah ta'ala. And we will sit like this even in Jannat, in the presence of Anbiya alayhimu salatu wa salam. And Al-Khali Hassan Ibisri Rahmatullah تعالى, who says that the jinns follow the same pattern religion-wise, like how human beings have their own religion. You will find jinns that are Christians, you will find jinns that are Jews, you will find jinns that are even Sunnis, you will find jinns that are Shia, you will find jinns that are Hindus, you will find jinns that are even Sahaba, companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as far as, let me say this to you, that the amount of jinns that had accepted Iman, embraced Iman on the hands of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is incalculable. You can't quantify it. Thousands and thousands of jinns came in the khidmat of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they became Muslims. Other prophets were there. They had the privilege that one or two or a few or a community would come and take shahada on their hands, but not like the status which was given to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So much so that even in the Quran today we have one entire chapter that is known as Suratul Jinn. And if you want to test any hafiz, I can give you a tip. Tell him to pray Surah Jinn. What do you do? Tell him to pray Surah Jinn. And believe me, you, he'll be in that state of trance. He'll become consumed. If his, you know, if his Quran's a bit weak. It's not hard. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرِ. We have made the Quran easy for you. We are the people who are the reciters. Quran is easy, simple. People have done it in 3 months. Maulana Hussain Madni memorized the Quran in prison in 30 days. A boy in Turkey memorized the Quran, entire Quran in 3 hours. He just memorized the Quran like that, photographic memory like this. Allah. You know, photographic memory. Flicking through the pages of the Quran, 3 hours it took him. The entire Quran was, subhanallah, permanently sealed in his heart. People are there, my respected brothers. This is ma'jiza. This is ma'jiza. Ma'jiza of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People came, sorry, jinn, thousands of jinns came in the khidmah. In fact, even the companions were there to witness the jinns. Companions. In our language we say, paak jinnat na paak jinnat. This is what the old ladies say. Paak jinnat and? Unfortunately, that term is not the right term. It's Muslim jinns or non-Muslim jinns. So, Muslim jinns are known as Pak jinnat. What do we say? There are so many jinns in this mosque, every mosque. And now Pak jinns would mean that non-Muslim shaitan. Okay, non-Muslim jinns. Shaitan is jinn. Non-Muslim jinns. Shaitan is just a name, but he is the jinn himself. He is a jinn and he is titled as a shaitan. You have different shayateen. Hazrat Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala anhu says that my father Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala was with Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the mountain of Tihama. On the mountain of? Who is the narrator? Hazrat Abdullah. He is the son of? Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, the father of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, father-in-law. Hazrat Hafsa was married to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was the daughter of Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala. And he says that my father was telling us about his own experience. He says that I was with Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the mountain of Tihama. And imagine, it would take something massive to overwhelm Hazrat Umar Farooq. To really shock Hazrat Umar Farooq, you need something out of this world. Hazrat Umar Farooq, he himself was a great figure, great status. He says that I was with Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of a sudden this giant figure came lurking towards Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Big figure. And as he came close, I noticed he was an old man with a staff. عصا in his hand. Very, very old, feeble, frail, walking slowly, slowly. Hazrat Umar said, when I looked at his, subhanAllah, the body, it was huge. And I was overwhelmed by this individual. I had never seen him. And he came to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he saw Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuhu. And straight away when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard his voice, he said that this is not the voice of a human being, this is the voice of a jinn. This is the voice of a jinn. And Hazrat Umar Farooq is there looking. And the jinn and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are there in communication. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, yes, I am a jinn. And he had transformed himself into a human being. Some jinns have the power, they like to be a human being, or they take the face of a snake or any other animal. Allah has given them. Some jinns have that power. Not all jinns have the ability to transform. Different jinns, different types of, subhanAllah, powers that Allah has given them. And he was there in that body of an old man. And he said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, I am a jinn. And Huzur alayhi salam looked at him and he said that, how old are you? How old are you? You want to listen to this, or do we make it part one, continue, part two, And he said that, Ya Rasulullah, I really don't know my real age, but I know one thing, that the first set of twins of Adam alayhi salam was Qabil and Habil. Who was it? Qabil had killed his brother Habil. You know the story. It's not time, there's no time to go in that story now. Qabil had killed his brother Habil. When Qabil had killed his brother Habil, the son of Adam alayhi salam, at that time I was 4 years old. At that time I was 4 years old. And he is there present in front of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, brother, tomorrow is Saturday. Huh? Subhanallah al-Azim. So he said, I was only four when Qabil killed his brother Habil, and I could understand how humans communicated. Even at that age, I was so powerful that I would incite evil actions for the children of Adam that were there. Adam alayhi salam. I would incite evil action even at that age. I was only 4 years old. To which Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who is more evil than you? That you have promoted evil all your life till this old age. Up to now. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, that is not the case. That is not the case. Alhamdulillah, I accepted Iman. I became a Muslim in the time of Nuh alayhi salam. In the time of? And ever since, I have taken residence in the masjids, in the masajid. I embraced Islam in the time of Nuh alayhi salam, and ever since that time, I have been occupying myself in the masajid. That's why you see the row of jinns in the mosque. It's that venue is just right for those jinns who are pious. And he says that I have personally learned the Torah, the commandments of Torah, directly from Musa alayhi salam. From Musa alayhi salam. And he says, from Nuh alayhi salam, I would always make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, don't give me death until I see the beautiful face of Khatamun Nabiyyin, Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhirin, Rahmatul Lil Alameen, Muhammad Mustafa, Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was the only aspiration left in my life. I have seen all the prophets, I have met all the prophets. And every single prophet prophesied about you, Ya Rasulullah. And every every scripture that was revealed to any prophet had a detailed description of you, O Prophet of Allah, and your companions, Ashabi Kiram Ridwanullahi Ta'ala Alayhim Ajma'in. And today my dream has come true, Ya Rasulullah. I have seen you. Allah has blessed me to this age. I am a Muslim. I have learned the Torah directly from Musa alayhi salam. Ya Rasulullah, only one tamanna is left. One ambition is left, only one thing. Ya Rasulullah, I would want to learn personally from you the scripture, the Quran that is revealed to you. It is said that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took that old jinn on one side. Huzur alayhi salam physically, personally taught him Suratul Waqi'ah, Suratul Naba. Naba? عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ عَنِ النَّبَإِ الْعَظِيمِ 30th Sipara beginning. وَالْمُرْسَلَاتِ عُرْفَى سُورَةُ الْمُرْسَلَاتِ 3 surahs. And سُورَةُ قُفِّرَتْ is a الشَّمْسُ قُفِّرَتْ 4 surahs. And حُزُورَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ taught him قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ سُورَةِ إِخْلَاصِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. He had the opportunity to learn all these surahs directly from Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in reality he was a jinn, but not an ordinary jinn. A jinn who was a sahabi jinn. And Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala anhu had the privilege of also seeing him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the tawfiq. Just for barakat's sake, I just want to read one hadith which I had started off the mawzu today. Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala says that it was the habit of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الْخَلَىٰ, every time he exited from the toilet, he would say, غُفْرَانَكْ. In one riwayat it is, غُفْرَانَكْ. I seek forgiveness from you, O Allah. So one must read غُفْرَانَكَ first, and then, الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَذْهَبَ عَنِّي الْأَذَىٰ وَأَفَانِي. Continuously, this dua was habitual for Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would always read this dua, Alhamdulillah illazi, all praises is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has discharged from my body products that were harmful for my body. Azhaba anni al-adha wa afani, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has relieved me from my agony and pain. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. We must not take any sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a trivial way. No sunnah of Rasulullah is light. We must make sure that every time we enter the toilet, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuth wal-khaba'ith is read, and every time we exit the toilet, this dua is read. Ghufranak alhamdulillahi alladhi azhaba anni al-adha wa afani. Jazakallah khair. Can I just remind the brothers, mashallah, we have a good gathering on a Friday. Please continue. Please continue, and inshallah you will benefit from it. We are learning a lot from the words of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also invite other people, other youngsters, you will be rewarded. And also on a Wednesday we have Darse Quran. Inshallah, please try to participate. Jazakallah khair. Dua karle. Okay. Yeah, okay. Brother, what we can do, we can just make dua now. So brothers who want to go, they can go. You can personally come to me. And it's a long explanation to that. Yes, you know why? Because we as Sunni Muslims, our brothers who want to leave, by all means they can go. I'm going to talk with him after dua. So just give me 1 minute. So that way brothers who want to sit, they can sit by all means. And brothers who want to go, they can go. Inshallah, dua to me. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Mursaleen. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inna kunna min al-zalimeen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, Ya Allah, amari gunaakum mu'afirma. Ya Allah, amari gunaakum mu'afirma. Ya Allah, amari gunaakum mu'afirma. Ya Allah, yahan jitne log baithe hue hain, Ya Allah, teri raza ke liye baithe hue hain. Ya Allah, tu humse razi ho ja. Ya Allah, tu humse razi ho ja. Ya Allah, jitne bhi gunah kiye hain, Ya Allah, tu rauf hai, rahim hai. Ya Allah, hume maaf kar de. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه وذرياته وأهل بيته أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. Brothers want to go, they can go, but it's a good question. Now what's your name, brother? Mustafa. And are you you are from Iran? Are you a Sunni Muslim or a Shia Muslim? Well, a Shia. You are a Sunni Muslim. Well, you are excluded from the majority of the people's belief of Iran. You see, I will tell you. Yeah, let me finish what I'm saying. I know you are startled at what I'm saying, but a lot of people are. And I have my experiences. I have even read Shia Kutubs. From day one, Shia people have always been the hypocrites. That is why Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu had banished Abdullah bin Sabah, who was a Jew, from Madinatul Munawwara, and he took up residence in Iran, and he was a Jew. And from day one, Shia were the first people to cause fitna in the system of Islam. They were the people who never took Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq as a Khalifa, and in